Okay, wonderful. So we are going to continue, and I promise you it gets even better, if that's even possible, because I'm in love with every one of our guests. They just bring so much value to us. And I want to share with you who's coming next. This woman is phenomenal. Her name is Jan Hargrave. She's a body language expert. She teaches you ways in which your body communicates with the world around you. She is the nation's leading behavioral authority and body language expert. She provides you skills that you need to read. If the key is read your family, your associates, your customers. In fact, everyone around you, you're going to see people a lot differently after you spend this time with Jan. She's the author of 5 books, including Let Me See Your Body Talk. We have all 5. Jardley is totally in love with Jan. It's a whole nother story. I'm not competing with her. I'm just telling you, he loves her. So do I. She shared her expertise for body language persuasion, influence in New York Times, ABC, NBC, CBS, Fox TV, Steve Harvey Show, entertainment. She's been everywhere. And she is phenomenal. She's also advised witness preparation for juries. She's advised presidents and vice presidents for the last 20 years. Please welcome my friend, Jan Hargrave. I'm excited. you're muted, my love.
Thank you.
Now I don't hear you still.
There we go. Am I there? Can you hear me?
I can hear you perfectly.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, I am so, congratulations, Lisa, you've been doing such a good job.
Well, thank you.
Have you had fun? Have you had fun, Lisa?
I have had fun. This actually was so much easier than I thought it would be. And because having 23 people to rely on, 23 people to show up was pretty interesting. I didn't know what I was asking for. And then when I did, and everyone brilliantly did, I feel very blessed.
Well, I am thrilled to be here. Let's teach some good stuff, you and I together.
Well, here's what I want to know. What have you evaluated in people's body language since COVID?
Well, you know, when this first came about, I thought, will they ever need to use a body language expert again? But then I realized it's really easier to read someone's body language during a virtual conversation and from 6 feet away than it was when I was face-to-face with that person. So then I did the research on that, and now my new topic that I speak on is nonverbal communication that builds trust and well-being during virtual conversations and during social distancing conditions, because there are a few secrets that you can use when you're in a virtual conversation with your body language, with your shoulders, with your eyes, with your like micro-expressions that can get you really into that other person. Because Lisa, the research said when I first started studying this, that it would take about 2 weeks of virtual conversations to be as socially grounded as one handshake was. So you understand, you know, when we shook hands with someone, we could tell if they were confident or nervous or prepared. And now you cannot do that, but you still have to establish pretty quickly a trust and a bond with the other person. And by doing the right things when you're in a virtual conversation, you can get it. You can, within 3 conversations virtually, you can be almost as socially grounded as you were in that handshake when you first greeted someone. And that's kind of good to know, though, just to have.
It is great to know. And I always knew, I've been studying the body language even before I met you, because I've been in sales all my life, 35 years. I'm going to make it shorter than it is. But but for a very long time, and I always knew it had everything to do with the handshake was equivalent to 3 hours of a conversation, all these other things, and the eye contact and the body movements and stuff. And when you said that, that was great, because I was curious about how people are interacting. One of the biggest challenges I even found on Zoom calls or GoToMeeting and GoToWebinar is that I want to look at you in the camera here on the video, but I know I need to look in the camera.
Yes, right. You're supposed to look in the camera. Yes,
I know I should look at the camera, but I totally want to look at you. And how does that actually affect anything if it does?
Well, as much as you, so what I teach people now is that we had to learn to reset expectations and learn how to use, I call it the triple threat, Lisa, triple threat. How to use your eyes, how to use your hands, how to use your posture when you're in now a virtual conversation. So perhaps we can, because think about this, we need other people really to survive. If you think of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you know, the first two are just that we need grounding, we need to feel safe, but the top three, we need other individuals to reach our full potential. So now that we're having to reach individuals probably more virtually than we could before. And the great thing, think about, you know, when I'm looking at someone from 6 feet away, I can look at everything about you. I can look at your face. I can look at your shoulders. I can look at your body. I can look at your feet. So for me as a body language expert, it's almost easier for me to read you that way. So my thing is that I read people, and it's been so fun because now I see everybody just really close up, and I'm thinking to myself, oh, they should have put their shoulders this way. They should have used their hands this way. So when we're thinking about resetting expectations, maybe I can teach some tips about how to really use your eyes and really what to look at. So think about it, 55% of our communication is nonverbal, 55%. So the moment someone sees you, whether it's in person or during a virtual call, they're going to make that snap judgment and decide for themselves, will I like that person? Will I trust that person? Will I even want to have a conversation with them? So when you're first coming on, they're getting a read on you. So that's 55% of our communication. 38% of our communication is our voice inflection, and this is the time where we can shine on that because you can let someone know how happy, how excited you are in the tones that you use when you're speaking. And then in body language, it says that only 7% of our communication does come from the words that we say. So not only do we have to use the words, we have to use our hands, and it is perfectly okay during these virtual conversations that every now and then you let people see your hands. And I'll give you a few hand motions that I think are pretty powerful for people to use even during virtual conversations. So as I go through this part of the triple threat and I talk about the eyes, let's just mention some of that before. We are supposed to look in the camera. We really should because it does say that to really make a connection with someone, you have to give them about 60 to 70% of the time you're talking with them. I really need to meet there. So I should look here every now and then, but I know that's difficult because you want to look at the person. But what happens is that, and Lisa, look at yours while I look at my camera this way. When we're this deeply into each other's eyes, a connection becomes vital. And what happens, the pituitary gland lets out a hormone called oxytocin. It's called the cuddle hormone. Women are using it when they're giving birth. I'm not giving birth to anyone right now while I'm talking with you, but I do want to cuddle you. So Lisa, so when we're doing that 60, 70% of the time, and as much as you can, every now and then look at your camera. So maybe placing your camera at a place that's maybe in the middle of your computer, make sure that you're doing that. So I would say to really give them good eye contact, make sure that you don't excessively blink your eyes when you're speaking, because that's a sign of deception in the courtroom. And if I saw you doing that, I'd say, wow, this person's getting ready to lie to me. Make sure that you don't keep your eyes closed for too long when you're talking. Some people who do this, that means that they're trying to block out information about themselves from you. And you could also even be aware of what we call the sharpshooter eye. And that's where someone kind of looks at you, kind of closes their eyes a bit, and they're looking at you. It has two meanings. Either that they're trying to catch you in saying something bad, or they're trying to really, really get the information that you're giving them. So I would want to make sure that you know, give them good eye contact. Let them know that you trust them. Let them know that you want to continue the conversation with them. And while we're talking about faces, two other things you can mention now, because eyebrows are really important now, and the kind of smile you're having during a virtual conversation. Your eyebrows are most important when you're wearing your mask, though, because when we're wearing our mask, we're this way and we can't see someone's smile. So you can greet people by just lifting those eyebrows. And except, you know, I had a little Botox shot, so I don't know if my eyebrows are working well. I have not had one in a long time. I've been glued here at my house. But if you can, my lady friends do not have a lot of Botox. If you would just, you know, kind of lifting the eyebrows is a sign of acknowledgement. So you might want to do that every now and then. And then also remember that a true smile is where it involves the bottom here, your lips that go out completely here from here, and that the eyes crinkle. So even if someone's hidden behind a mask, you know, their mouth is hidden behind a mask, you can tell if they're smiling at you because the eyes are going to crinkle, and they have happy eyes compared to someone who just has what we call a grapefruit smile, just this, where it's just pasted on. So as much as you can, get it from down here and just give a good smile that away. So as far as your hands, your face, I want you to remember that. I want to just mention shoulders for a minute before I get into posture and hands. Try to, as much as possible, have your body squared, because when we're shaking someone's hand, we're supposed to be belly button to belly button. We should still be that same way when we're having this virtual conversation with another. And when your shoulders are squared, you look really confident. Never stay with one shoulder raised for too long, because unevenness of shoulders is indecisiveness of person. So as much as you can, and it's okay to move a bit, but try to be pretty squared on, make sure your lighting is good. And then I want to mention some things that maybe people can do with their hands, because people begin to trust you quickly when they can see a few hand motions from you. I know that sounds silly, but you know, when they can see just a small one, you never want to make it big, and that is crazy, but every now and then, if you can just, and I'll teach you a couple that I think people should do. And when you're using your hand motions, as much as you can, don't have them cut and dry. Just maybe have them a little bit more, that they're flowing as they're talking with you. So what generally happens in conversations, when we're wanting someone to stay away from us, our hands usually go away this way. When we're wanting someone to come into our conversation with us, we typically bring our hands towards us. So every now and then, if you just want to talk and maybe do this kind of motion, it would be perfectly okay. The one that I always advise people to do, whether you're virtually talking with them or an in-person conversation, is to every now and then give yourself some and do yourself a little steeple. And a steeple gesture is when all my fingertips are together, and it's usually done about chest level. So, you know, just in talking casually, look, I'm going to do it real casually. You never want to sit there and do this because it looks like you're praying. But maybe if you're in a casual conversation, you might want to just bring your hands together and do this. Steepling is always, always going to be indicative of someone's level of confidence. It doesn't have to be done with all my fingertips together. I could put my hands this way. It's called a goalpost steeple, and maybe emphasize a point. I think that's a good gesture you can do now. And another gesture that people can do that works really well, it's pretend that I'm holding onto an imaginary basketball with my hands, and I'm talking, doing this. And then I reach forward to you, and it's almost as though I'm giving you the ball. In other words, I'm saying, I have this information in the ball of my hands, and I will gladly share it with you. So anytime you can just move the hand somewhat, but you should never, ever touch your face when you're on one of these virtual calls, because we call those gestures when someone touches the face too much or fixes the hair too much. Those are called displacement gestures, and we often see them in the courtroom when someone's really nervous. And that they're getting ready to be dishonest with us. So a displacement gesture would be someone pulling imaginary lint off of their jacket. That's a displacement gesture. Someone may be scratching the arm here when you know that it does not itch. That's a displacement gesture. Someone constantly fooling of their clothing. That's displacement gesture. Someone scratching the neck, they usually do it 5 times, is a displacement gesture. And then tossing of the hair is almost too frivolous. If you're having a serious conversation, it almost undermines some of the things that you've just said. So as much as you can, you know, make the gestures kind of flow, make them full. And the thing that you have to realize is that the bigger you make yourself, I know that's going to sound crazy to most people because we always want to diet and get so thin, but the bigger you can make yourself body-wise, the more space you look like you need, the more powerful you can come across to someone. So if you stay with your arms crossed and you stay tiny like this, you look as though someone could pounce upon you and get their way. So every now and then, if you'd sit and maybe put an arm here, because think how Oprah interviews. She doesn't interview people with her hands crossed in front of herself.
See how I'm moving?
Say that again, Lisa. Yeah, see you moving, girl. You squirming. You're just squirming right now. You're nervous with me up here. But, you know, she'll put her arm on this chair this way and she'll talk with you. So every now and then, if you want to give that aura of authority, you can kind of go in this manner where your shoulders are spread out, but you cannot stay too tiny. And if you're in a listening position to someone, make sure that you're not this way, because when you cannot see someone's hands, it's very defensive. It's almost as though they're thinking, I don't care what you're saying, I'm not even listening. But if they do see your complete body and you want to cross your hands and your arms, make sure that you have at least, you know, either one hand, this one hand sharing is perfectly okay. It's called a resting position or a coach's position, or you could put your hands this way. So more so if you're going to cross, when you're listening to someone, make sure that you do some kind of something that your hands are showing. Because I don't want to tell people not to cross, because I know it's very comfortable to cross your arms. But if you're listening and you're thinking they're really watching you, make sure that you at least show some of the hands when you're speaking or listening. And one thing that you do so well, Lisa, when you're listening, is that you tend to kind of tilt your head. So when people are listening and they tilt their head, that's a big sign of interest. You know, because if someone's talking, the head is usually straight up. But when someone's listening and you're tilting your head, and another one that you do really well is your head nods. You normally go twice, which is perfect, because people, when they're in agreement, they go twice, like, Uh-huh. And when they're ready for you to shut up and for them to talk, they normally go three times. So when you're in these virtual conversations and you see someone go three times, that means they want you to be quiet because they need to say something now. So that's kind of good. We have our own little language, don't we, Lisa?
I love this. I have an itch on my head. I'm afraid to scratch.
Yeah, don't move your hands. You know what, too, Lisa?
And I have to go to the bathroom, so I have a bio break and it failed, and you're thinking I'm fidgeting, and I'm sitting here going, no matter what I do, this is going to be very interesting.
And Lisa, here's a quick experiment. Now that, you know, when you're walking 6 feet away from someone, you see someone, let's say you're at the park and you're walking towards them, how do you greet them? Do you, you know, you might not be able to say hi because we have a mask. So let me show you the differences. Do you greet them by going with your chin up like, hey, or do you go with your chin down like, hi? What do you think you do? You go up or you go down?
I think I'd probably go up.
I haven't
gone out.
Now you can try and go, hey, or you can go, hey. So let me just tell you the difference. People who raise the chin up are really the confident people. Yeah. And people who lower the chin are the more compassionate people.
Okay. So I am compassionate, but I'm probably pretty confident.
Confident too. So now when you will greet people, it'll be kind of interesting that you see that, you know, that you're noticing what they're doing there. So that gives a few little things for people to watch for, but it's so vital that you build this body of trust with them really quickly. Another way to do it is to get several me toos in the first 7 minutes of the conversation. So I might say to you, I love warm weather. You too? And you'd say, oh yeah, me too. And or I'd say, I love pink. And you'd say, oh, me too. So the more me toos you can get in the first 7 minutes, the quicker you're going to bond with them. It's like you would have clicked the like or the love button on your Facebook page. So try to think about that, but you have to deal with people now in the spirit of love, and you need to deal with them in the spirit of sincerity, because even though you're acting like you're interested in what someone's saying right now, because you can see the faces of people so clearly on these virtual calls, you will be able to spot when they're not genuine and they're saying, yeah, I believe you. But so that's why you have to be so attuned to facial expressions. There's only seven universal facial expressions: happiness, sadness, fright, contempt. So if you know those seven, and there are tests, and I can send you to a website that, you know, they'll show you a face and you have to say right away, is that a sad face, a happy face, a content face? So, and if you, it's only 20 faces they show you, and we'd like people to score between, you know, 17 out of 20 on the face recognition scoring sheet, but some people right now are just scoring 9 and 10. So the faster you can get to understand what the facial expression is giving you, the quicker you can bond and understand the deep needs that those people have. So we need to just be sincere. I think we need to be really loving, because I think people are going through some really tough times right now. So as much as we can, and you know, the giving that we're doing now, I think will bring us rewards when everything comes out better. Don't you think, Lisa?
I do. You've given so much information. I'm just taking it in and saying, okay. It's my sister. It's like, let's just go, which is great. And now every time I'm itching, I'm sitting here going, what does this mean? What is Jan going to tell me it means? You know, one thing that I'd like to talk about, you talk about even how you're sitting and how you're presenting, and I'm thinking as I'm sitting here that even the way I'm sitting, and I see you're further back, and I feel like maybe I should have had the camera so you can see more of me, because then you would see my hands, where before I would have had to make an effort where if I would have picked my hand up, you would have seen it, but because I was close, I'm being serious, you might not see.
No, I like you close. I think you're good close. You're good close. And then, you know, if you need to bring back just for a second, but no, you're better close, Lisa. You are.
Well, because what you were saying before with the hands, and I'm pretty literal, so then I'm thinking, okay, well, how do I make sure, and I'm thinking other people probably may think this too, how do I show my hands where it'd be natural? And I know matching and mirroring and all the other stuff.
Yeah.
But that's why I thought, do I need to actually move back and change the camera angle?
I think you're perfect as you are. And, you know, every now and then you probably do lean back and you probably make your hands come up somewhat. Because I don't want, you know, there are times I don't want to see any hands. I think it's better that we just focus on your face and all the emotion that you come out with in your face with, and the sincerity in you, and the, you know, just everything about the faces now are just communicating. But every now and then, you don't look like just a face. Every now and then, you know, you can sit back when you're going to do a point and maybe bring your hands forward or maybe do the steeple gesture, maybe do the basketball gesture, some of the, those things. And maybe we could teach your group a couple of gestures of dishonesty that they should avoid when they're talking on these virtual calls.
That's awesome. Yes.
Because, you know, and, I mean,
know what's so interesting is that what you're sharing and what you know is obvious, a lot of people don't realize that's when we talk, when you talk about the body language and the body's telling a different story. And we may not even be aware, we meaning human beings, may not even be aware we're telling a different story. So listening to these tips is super critical so that you make sure that you're congruent with what you are telling people.
Yeah, and you hit it right on the head because, Lisa, you know, the wording actions speak louder than words. So I could tell you all day that I love you, but unless I have the sincerity behind those words, you will never feel that I love you. So especially now, you know, we're seeing people's faces so clearly, we have to make sure that we, you know, let people know how we feel. Yeah. So to just kind of refresh some people's minds, and I work in the courtroom, I pick juries, and I teach people how to spot liars and truth tellers. And so one big thing that people ask me to come speak to their groups about is how to catch a liar or how to catch if someone's telling the truth. So I'll just give you a briefing. I'll give you three gestures of dishonesty, two gestures of honesty, and then you make sure that during your virtual conversations, don't you ever use the dishonesty gestures, but make sure that you use the honesty gestures often. So this is how it works. So let me just explain why your hands move when you're talking. Your hands move when you're talking because your hand movement helps you get information that is located inside this wonderful, beautiful brain of yours. If you could not use your hands and you had to tie your hands behind your back to speak, it would become very difficult to organize your thoughts and get them out in a logical fashion. So that's why your hands move. Your hands move, they help you organize your wording and think which hand moves and why that hand moves. When I move my right hand, all of the motion on my right side of my body, my hand motion, my leg motion, my eye motion, all of this motion is controlled from the left side of my head. So my left brain is my math, my science, my history. If I am multiplying something inside my brain and have trouble getting the numbers multiplied, I would end up moving my right hand. It would help clarify and I could speak those words. So when my left brain works, that's when my right hand is working. When I move my left hand, that's coming from the right side of my head. In my right brain, that's the fun side, the comical side. This is the side, the daydreams. If ever you drove somewhere and you can't remember how you got there, well, you drove their right brain. So think of how your hands move and think wonderful that they do because it helps you organize all your thoughts. So what we have found is when people are going to be difficult with us in the courtroom and probably going to fabricate a story, they will more than likely gesture with this left hand. And it's not that left-handed people lie more than right-handed people. It's just that the left hand, because it's controlled from the right side of the hand, this is where you make up a story. When you tell a lie, it's coming from right here. So because of that, my left hand, and I don't know if it appears that my left hand is showing, but I'm raising my left hand now. We gesture with that left hand when we lie. The number one gesture that people do when they're uncomfortable and getting ready to tell you something that's not true, they're going to take that left index finger. They'll talk and talk and talk for a bit, and then they'll bring it when they tell you the lie, and they will begin to rub up and down the left side of their nose. A liar typically does this. He rubs up twice and then bends the finger and then rubs underneath the nose this way. Liars usually go up twice and then down back and forth twice. So I'm sure you've seen someone say, "Hey, girl, you look real good." And you believe them. They were lying to you. But I'm a teacher, so I never want to tell you something and not tell you some background about it. What happens, and I'll do it in slow motion, when I'm touching my nose, what I'm doing is that I'm trying to distract you from the information coming from my mouth. So when I do this and when I do this motion here, what really is going on is that my hand is in front of my mouth trying to distract you from the information that is coming out of the mouth. So when you bring your hand here, you're distracting people with your fingernails, your rings, your watches. And also the reason that a liar tends to want to touch the nose when they're telling you something that's fabricated is that every time you lie, you get a tingling sensation in your nose. And because of it, you end up rubbing it. Wow. I know that you never touch your nose again with your left hand. If ever your left side of your nose itches, just come around this way and just rub it here. Well,
but I just want you to know, we're going to be running short of time.
So that's okay.
I want to make sure that we have a chance for people to be able to reach you and stuff. And I can say that I don't use my left hand to do that because I have a challenge. I don't like liars, and I don't want to lie. And
way to go, Lisa.
So I'm safe. It'll be like...
So Lisa, of course, you know, my website is, my name is just janhargrave.com, and I wrote an online course. Of course, it's on there, janhargrave.com/course. It's really good. It's 13 modules, gives you all the information you need about body language to negotiate, to sell with people. And also I'm going to send everyone a handout. If they just text my name, Jan Hargrave 2, the number is 415-528-7403. And I think in my big giveaway, I said I will send people books if they win that, and I'll send some pink glasses. That's going to be the cool thing, is glasses for everyone. So let me just give you one last gesture of honesty, and it's taking my right hand, bringing it here. Huge honesty gesture. Right hand to the chest. It has to be with the fingers spread out. So Lisa, from my heart to yours, wonderful, wonderful time, and I hope our group listened and learned some good things.
Oh, they learned fabulous things, Jan. You are amazing. Thank you so much. I love you. I want more of you. And I'm sure everybody else does too. And we'll make sure they get that information. Can you just repeat the number one more time?
Okay. It's 415-528-7403. And all my books, I did a book on love, a book on sales, a book on liars, the whole bit, are on my site at janhargrave.com.
Thank you
so much for this opportunity.
Yeah, we got them all. They're worth getting. They're easy reads. They're great. They're insightful. You'll use it. It's really wonderful. And Jan, I love you. Thank you. And you're going to stay for the mastermind, right?
Yes.
So we'll see you shortly. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Bye.